Congressman, as president, your words have global ramifications. You know that. Do you think President Trump is aware of the consequences of those comments, of his comments there?
Absolutely, and I would actually agree with Philip, but I would expand it to say his audience wasn't just Kim Jong-un. It was China. It was the European Union. It was NATO. It was our allies across the globe. And what he was saying is, this is an extremely dangerous situation. This is what his cabinet members have been saying as well. And we need a worldwide solution here. We need a coalition. These sanctions, they have to be followed. We need to expand them further. We need to cut off North Korea and isolate this regime so that we can deal with it diplomatically, because we are in the 11th hour in the 59th minute here. And if you go back 20 or 30 years, every president has had to deal with this family, the Kim family, really since the Korean War. And so, but now they have the weapons. They've always had the insanity. And so I think the president is really raising the stakes here, but he's done it deliberately because he doesn't want the United States to do this alone.
Phil, why are you shaking your head?
That's not what the president said. Jack just said the president characterized this as a difficult, dangerous situation. I agree with that. The president threatened a foreign leader, and we don't understand how the foreign leader will interpret that threat. If the president said this were a dangerous situation and we need more action from the Chinese, I would understand that. No. Let's be clear about facts. That's not what he said.
But no, Phil, that is what he said. You can speak to the world, but direct it towards the North Korean regime, because what you've said, I agree with. You don't know how he's going to react, and I don't think the president is saying he's going to react one way or the other, but he does have a little bit more faith in our traditional allies and our traditional adversaries. And so he is speaking to them, and he would love to see China get off its stuff. He'd love to see Russia get involved.
But Jack, what's the interpretation of fire and fury? What's your interpretation?
I am not certain, but let me say this, I know Philip's been in it. I've sat on the Defense Committee, I sat in very many classified briefings, and you walk out of these hearings and you say, oh my gosh, I cannot believe the world is on the brink of the brink, and you just get this kind of fatigue feeling, and I think the President's been seeing some of these briefings, and he's saying, we have got to move, and that's why he was raising it, and I think that his statement...
Do you raise that on a world stage, or do you raise it inside the committee meeting, or inside the meeting with you?
Well, when you think about having, 35,000 American troops in the Korean Peninsula, you have millions of... South Koreans, you've got Japan, maybe you have Guam with Americans, maybe you just don't know where this guy's going to go, and I'm saying, he is saying, this could be a four-bell fire alarm here, a five-bell, whatever the saying is. I think he's being real serious, and I think he does want the world...
You don't think there should be more precision in the president's words, that he should be more precise and not left open to interpretation? I don't really see any other way that you can interpret fire and fury. Does anybody else on the panel see another way to interpret fire and fury when you're talking about a miniature nuclear warhead? I mean, and you're talking about the possibility of war. Does anybody else see...
I think fire and fury in itself could have meant a conventional military strike of some sort. I think what elevated it to the nuclear level was the "let the world has never seen." So we come back to that hyperbolic phrase again.
All right, stick with me, everyone. When we come back, the president's credibility problem goes way back. A history of Donald Trump's trouble with the truth. That's next.